Men freeze in place, holding pickaxes and shovels at the ready inside a well-lit tunnel under the Mexican countryside. They can hear the vibrations of a vehicle above them and, wary of making any noise that might give them away, hold their work as the prison patrol passes overhead. 30 feet below the prison's main yard, there's little chance of being discovered. But after several months of secret tunneling, they can't take any chances, especially when they are so close to their goal. The prison cell of Mexico's most famous drug kingpin, Joaquin El Chapo Guzman. For months, they've tunneled through solid rock with nothing more than pickaxes and shovels, moving as fast as they can with their limited equipment but with great caution. The work would go much faster if they could use modern tunnel digging equipment like jackhammers and boring machines. But not only would that create noise that might give them away, it would draw a great deal of attention to their staging area, just a mile from the prison perimeter. Prior to tunnel digging, El Chapo's powerful drug cartel purchased a small plot of land as close to the prison as they could get and began constructing two small homes as a cover for their real intentions. The homes never made it past a rough brick outer shell, though, because of course they would not be inhabited. Instead, they provided the cover needed to start construction on the tunnel that would set El Chapo free. But the tunnel crew was facing incredible pressure to finish as quickly as possible. Due to his history of escaping from prison and evading police raids, Mexican authorities could at any time transfer El Chapo to another prison in order to foil any possible escape attempts. Every day the tunnelers took to get their boss was another day the entire thing could be for nothing, and a new escape attempt in a completely different location would have to be devised. But that's not all. The unfinished buildings were beginning to draw attention from local officials and curious villagers alike. Why would someone start construction on an empty piece of land and then suddenly stop with only a shell of a home built? Time was running out and pressure was mounting. Inside his cell, El Chapo was the model prisoner. Despite his long history of ordering some of the most horrific violence Mexico has ever seen, El Chapo maintained a cordial and even pleasant attitude with his prison guards and fellow inmates. His conversations over the phone were carefully monitored, his mail checked by prison officials, but not a single hint of the ongoing plot was ever revealed. El Chapo was a true professional by now and patient, but his patience was running out. The tunnel diggers faced a daunting task from the start, and they knew they had to move fast. Despite the incredible pressure on them, however, they managed to not only reach El Chapo before any potential prison transfer, but they wound up breaking through to El Chapo's cell just 16 months into his prison stay. The tunnel they constructed was sophisticated, impressing officials who would later remark that a tunnel of that magnitude should have taken 18 months to 2 years to construct. Its walls were reinforced when needed, with wooden paneling, and a generator pumped fresh air through a mile-long ventilation system to keep the tunnel oxygenated. On the ground, the tunnelers had laid down rails and used a motorcycle to shuttle two carts, which were filled with dirt back and forth along the shaft. Once El Chapo was reached, he would ride on that same motorcycle and quickly shuttle the mile distance to freedom. All that dirt, though, had to go somewhere. And so the tunnelers cleverly transferred it to the tunnel opening, where others would spread the dirt around on the field outside, rather than dump it in giant piles, which would no doubt draw attention. Still, the presence of fresh dirt littering acres of empty fields was sure to eventually draw attention and questions that would not be easy to answer for the fake construction crew above ground. Suddenly, though, in the middle of the night on July 12, 2015, the sound of metal scraping came from El Chapo's shower inside his cell. Moments later, the ceramic bottom of the shower popped free, and a friendly face greeted the imprisoned drug lord, beckoning him into the darkness below. Wasting no time, El Chapo ducked into the secret tunnel, climbing down 30 feet into a tunnel only as wide across as a man, but just tall enough for El Chapo to stand upright. Often derided for his short stature by his enemies, the tunnel diggers had made sure that the tunnel was just tall enough so the boss wouldn't have to hunch as he walked along it. A classy prison escape if we ever heard of one. A few feet into the mouth of the tunnel, El Chapo boarded a small motorcycle which had been affixed to metal tracks. The carts full of dirt that had pushed along for months now were gone, and just moments after leaving his cell, El Chapo was cruising along the well-lit tunnel like a kid on an amusement park ride. 2 minutes later, El Chapo ended his joyride by climbing up wooden steps and popping up into the empty shell of a home his crew had been secretly working from for a year and a half. Changing into clean clothes, El Chapo then climbed onto a truck and whisked away into the dark of the night, leaving behind an incredible mile-long secret tunnel and completely frustrated prison system and Mexican government both. El Chapo would be caught again just months after his escape, after his newest safe house was given away weeks before his arrival by careless gunmen who were spotted by locals. Responding to reports of heavily armed men, Mexican officials put the house under surveillance and intercepted communications saying that grandma or aunt was coming to visit. Realizing this had to be a high-value target, officials waited for their chance to strike. 1 month later, Mexican Special Forces soldiers raided the home and killed several bodyguards, but El Chapo and one of his most senior lieutenants escaped via, you guessed it, a secret tunnel. Popping up a mile from the home, the two stole a vehicle at gunpoint, though the driver immediately reported it to the police. After issuing an alert for the stolen vehicle, the federal police officers discovered the stolen car and placed the two fugitives under arrest. El Chapo, however, wouldn't go without at least trying to buy his freedom. Knowing how easily corruptible public officials had been in the past, El Chapo bribed the police officers, offering them money, homes, and even lucrative jobs if they let him go. Little did the desperate kingpin know, however, that he was dealing with a brand new brand of Mexican police officer. One not as easily corrupted as his predecessors. All four officers refused El Chapo, after which his offers of honey turned into vinegar, telling the police officers that they were all going to die. The four officers sent pictures to El Chapo to their superiors, only to be warned that the police had received a tip-off that 40 heavily armed assassins were en route to free El Chapo. With friendly forces still tied up at the compound, the officers were ordered to a nearby motel on the outskirts of town, where they holed themselves up in an empty room and prepared for a possible shootout for their lives. All the while, El Chapo laughed, echoing his previous threats. Suddenly, a convoy of vehicles lit up the roadside, clearly headed for the lonely motel. The officers, armed with M16 assault rifles and pistols, prepared for what was surely their last stand. El Chapo taunted them, telling them they were about to face death, and after them, their families. Yet the officers held their ground, ready to die for duty's sake if need be. As the vehicles began to turn into the parking lot, however, El Chapo's taunts died in his throat. Once the glare of the headlights faded, the barricaded officers could see military trucks full of Mexican Marines rushing to take up defensive positions around the motel. Minutes later, a thoroughly defeated and dejected-looking El Chapo was dragged into an SUV and rushed off to an airfield. El Chapo would not escape from Mexican prison again, and 2 years later, any hope of ever escaping again would be extinguished as Mexico approved an extradition request to the United States. Safely in U.S. custody, El Chapo faces life in prison. And though he may have been one of the deadliest men in Mexico's history, the drug kingpin would ultimately be remembered as nothing more than a sobbing mess as he begged U.S. justice officials for leniency, which they would not grant.
For many, the thought of prison is enough to keep them on the straight and narrow. But for others, prison is merely a consequence of their chosen lifestyle. And for a select few, prison is nothing more than a challenge, a puzzle begging to be solved. Today, we'll look at some of the more creative escapes in this episode of the Infographic Show, The Greatest Prison Escapes in History. We're starting off with a classic, fictionalized by Hollywood into the film The Great Escape, starring Steve McQueen. Though the real story is fraught with far more drama than what could fit on the silver screen. In World War II, the prisoner of war camp known as Stalag Luft III was thought to be the most secure POW camp in Europe. Hundreds of miles southeast of Berlin, it was located deep in enemy territory and featured a host of security features meant to make it difficult to escape from. Along with barbed wire fences, the Germans had sunk microphones 9 feet deep into the soil all along the perimeter in order to detect the sound of digging. The prisoners' huts were all built on stilts, raised up above the ground so any tunnel would be immediately visible. Lastly, the sandy soil made it nearly impossible to dig through, threatening collapse at any moment. Yet none of these things stopped a band of British, Canadian, Australian, French, and American airmen from attempting an escape anyways. The plan was to build 3 tunnels codenamed Tom, Dick, and Harry. Using only metal silverware and milk tin cans, the prisoners painstakingly chipped away at the building support columns of 3 different huts in order to avoid being seen working underneath them. They accessed their below-floor workspace via a secret trapdoor over which they kept a heating stove permanently lit in order to discourage any Nazi guards from getting too close. In order to solve the microphone problem, the escapees dug their tunnels a whopping 30 feet deep, excavating an astonishing 100 tons of sand all by hand. To avoid raising suspicion, the excavated sand was concealed in stuffed socks, which they would sprinkle discreetly on garden soil being raked by other prisoners. To shore up their tunnel walls, the prisoners stripped 4,000 wooden bedboards and then lined each tunnel with 1,700 blankets to muffle the sounds of digging. They converted discarded milk tins into lamps with wicks made from pajama cords and burned in mutton fat the prisoners skimmed off the greasy soup they were served. Stealing a few hundred feet of electrical wire, the prisoners even managed to fashion their own work lights, which they plugged directly into the camp's electrical supply. And if that's not enough ingenuity, the prisoners also created an air pump using hockey sticks and other discarded bits of trash, and even built an underground trolley system to transport the excavated sand. On March 24, 1944, the prisoners finally made their escape. Forced to move one by one through the cramped tunnels, barely a dozen managed to make it out per hour, and at one point, a one-hour blackout during an air raid further slowed the escape attempt. At around 5 a.m., however, disaster struck, with a Nazi guard on patrol nearly falling into the exit shaft of one of the three tunnels and discovering the plot. A massive manhunt was mobilized, and eventually the Germans recovered 73 of the 76 escapees. Three, however, would make it to safety. Two Norwegians, who stowed away on a freighter to Sweden, and a Dutchman, who made his way to Gibraltar by rail and foot. A furious Hitler ordered the execution of 50 of the escapees, violating the Geneva Convention. Years after the war, a military tribunal found 18 Nazi soldiers guilty of war crimes for shooting the recaptured POWs, and 13 of them were executed. As one of the largest manhunts in American history, the prison escape of the Texas Seven in December of 2000 made headlines around the world. On December 13, 2000, the seven inmates convinced a maintenance supervisor to let them skip lunch so they could wax the floors of the maintenance room. Distracting the supervisor, one of the inmates knocked him unconscious with a blow to the back of the head, then undressed him, tied him up, and locked him in an electrical room. During this time, three other inmates, four prison guards, and nine supervisors wandered into the room, and incredibly, all were subdued by the inmates. That's when the Texas Seven put their plan into action. By impersonating various supervisors over the telephone, the inmates got out of 12 headcounts, and then making their way to the gatehouse, incredibly conned their way inside by pretending to be monitor installers. Once inside the gatehouse, the prisoners subdued the lone guard and got his firearm along with a few other weapons from a weapons cache. Then the prisoners opened the back gate and drove their way out in a stolen pickup truck, launching a multi-state manhunt that would be one of the largest in American history. Eventually found, thanks in part to the television program America's Most Wanted, the prisoners even demanded a TV appearance before they would agree to surrender. In the end, no such appearance would be granted, and all of the seven were brought back into custody. There's never been a more iconic prison in history than Alcatraz, and naturally, it is the setting for our greatest prison escape story. A lifelong criminal, Frank Morris was serving a 10-year stint for bank robbery when he broke out of the Louisiana State Penitentiary, only to be recaptured a year later and sent to Alcatraz. Ranked in the top 2% of the population in intelligence and with an IQ of 133, Morris paid no heed to Alcatraz's reputation as an inescapable prison and quickly went to work developing an escape plan. Partnering with brothers John and Clarence Anglin and car thief Alan West, the four prisoners discovered an unguarded utility corridor that ran just behind their cells, which housed a ventilation shaft to the roof. Utilizing scavenged saw blades, spoons stolen from the commissary, and even a home-built drill made from the motor of a broken vacuum cleaner, the four gradually widened the ventilation duct opening in each of their cells. The holes were concealed using cardboard and paint, and Morris's accordion provided cover for the sound of their work. Once inside the utility corridor, the four climbed to the roof of their cell block and set up a small workshop there. Using stolen and donated materials, the four made makeshift life preservers using 50 raincoats from a design they had seen in an issue of Popular Mechanics. They also used the raincoats to create a 6x14-foot rubber raft and used a small accordion-like concertina they stole from another inmate as a bellows to inflate the raft. Their paddles were made from scrap wood and stolen screws. On the night of June 11, 1962, the men began their escape. Of the four, though, Alan West was unable to leave his cell, having used cement to shore up the crumbling concrete around the vent opening in his cell, which threatened to give him away. Once dried, the cement narrowed the escape hole and fixed the steel grill in place, and by the time he had re-widened his hole and removed the grill, the others had already left without him. The other three inmates climbed the ventilation shaft to the roof, then hauled their homemade life preservers and raft 50 feet down a kitchen vent pipe to the ground, and then scaled two 12-foot barbed wire fences. Somewhere along the northeast shoreline of Alcatraz, where the prison's network of searchlights and gun towers had a blind spot, the men inflated their raft and then rowed into the dense fog, trying to reach Angel Island 2 miles to the north. In the ensuing manhunt, police would recover one of the paddles and bits of raft and life preservers, but no sign of the men. With their stated plan having been to steal clothing in a car, and no vehicle or clothing thefts reported in the area after the escape, the police finally concluded that in all likelihood, the men drowned in the strong currents and frigid waters of San Francisco Bay.
Some 70,000 convicts were sent here, but very few made it out alive, with conditions harsh enough to shatter the spirits of even the most resilient criminals. This was truly a land of torment, the final destination for many unfortunate souls. Welcome to Devil's Island, the world's most notorious prison to ever be forgotten. Sounds like a contradiction, doesn't it? With a treacherous landscape and an ominous past, you'd better watch your step because danger lurks in every direction. The name Devil's Island was actually coined by the prisoners themselves, which should give you some clue about the conditions that they lived in. Officially, it was called Banya de Cayenne, otherwise known as the Penal Colony of Cayenne, located about 9 to 10 miles off the Atlantic coast from Kourou, a small town in French Guinea on the northeastern coast of South America, resides three small rocky islands. These are known as the Salvation Islands, also known as the Île de Salut in French. In this case, the term salvation would seem like an oxymoron. The smallest of the three islands is Devil's Island, a narrow strip of land about 3,900 feet long and roughly 1,320 feet wide. Don't let the palm trees fool you. This was no island paradise. Today, an overgrown jungle is slowly hiding the remnants of what was once a penal or exile colony, a virtual hell here on Earth. Established by the Emperor Napoleon III in 1852, the island was originally used as a leper colony to quarantine people with leprosy before later being used to incarcerate political prisoners and criminals. Throughout a long stretch of time consisting of around 100 years, many were convicted here, including murderers, rapists, and those deemed as an overall threat to society. Some men, however, were sent here despite being innocent of the charges that were staged against them. It didn't matter what category of criminal you were listed under. If you were unlucky enough to be sent here, you endured the same fate as everyone else. Items on the agenda included squeezing into tight living spaces, getting covered in dirt, and being abused by other inmates. Whether you were a petty thief or a savage murderer, you could expect to be stripped of your identity and thrown into the mix. You were forced to cohabit the same environment and mingle with those more dangerous than you. Not surprisingly, fights were a regular occurrence amongst the prisoners, many of which ended in murders that later went unpunished. No one really cared whether people lived or died. Isolated on a treacherous island with no way out, why would anyone bother punishing the prisoners? It only required paperwork, a guide was quoted saying to Atlas Obscura during a visit to the island. It was easier, he explained, to let nature take its course and let them die of harsh labor, tropical disease, or a failed attempt to escape. When the prisoners were punished on rare occasions, they were commonly put in isolation for months at a time. Imagine going a long time in a dark room with no one to talk to. Some convicts were even placed in deep 12-by-12-foot holes with bars on top instead of a roof, so that they'd be subject to all kinds of weather conditions without a shelter to protect them. One prisoner was reportedly tied to a tree deep in the jungle as punishment for attempting to attack a guard. He was left to endure the elements, vulnerable to nature's wrath. The next day, he was discovered dead. Out of 70,000-something men, three-quarters of them died from disease, hunger, and mistreatment. Many also fell prey to insects such as ants, as well as bats and rats picking at their rotting bodies. Many convicts even died on the way to the island, since even the trip in and of itself was extremely dangerous. Many inmates were forced to share tiny, cramped cells with one another in filthy conditions. To put this in perspective, these cells were about the same size as the common household bathroom. As an exercise, if you were trying to squeeze your entire family into one, maybe you'd have a better idea of what it might have been like. Say goodbye to your privacy. We wouldn't recommend trying this if you're claustrophobic, though. After 1885, the population of Devil's Island greatly increased as the French government started sending more prisoners, including an influx of more convicts charged with smaller offenses, not just hardened criminals. The conditions became ever more crowded as a result. Prisoners were routinely shackled at night, their legs tied to an iron rod. With a natural desire to shift and adjust your sleeping position throughout the night, it's easy to imagine that this would have been torture. During the day, prisoners were forced to move around in chains, with starvation being common. Many resembled walking skeletons. A lot of prisoners anticipated death and probably welcomed it when it finally came. Though there is a graveyard located on the island to this day, most of the prisoners were not buried there. Due to its hazardous rocks and powerful ocean currents surrounding the island, safe access was only possible using a cable car, which crossed the 60-foot-wide channel between Devil's Island and the main island, Île Royale. Though on every prisoner's mind, escape was very difficult to achieve. Some might even say impossible. The rough landscape was its own challenge, with sharp rocks and piranha-infested rivers. And sharks also posed a serious threat. These killer monsters circled the island constantly, eagerly waiting to feast on the prisoners. They were even said to respond to the ring of a bell like trained dogs whenever it was time to dispose of the corpses. The bodies of the dead convicts were on the menu, loaded into wheelbarrows and dumped into the ocean. The piranhas were basically handed a free meal on a silver platter. Many who tried to escape also perished in the water. One well-known prisoner to be brought to Devil's Island was a man named Captain Alfred Dreyfus. Born in 1859, this French army officer was the son of a wealthy Jewish family. He was accused of selling military secrets to the Germans in 1894 and was put on trial for treason. He was convicted and sentenced to life imprisonment, and he arrived at Devil's Island on April 13, 1895. His case, however, initiated a 12-year controversy known as the Dreyfus Affair, which made a lasting impact on the political and social history of the French Third Republic. During this time, the French press was highly anti-Semitic, and the evidence that had been used against him was largely fabricated. Dreyfus reportedly cried out, giving a passionate plea. He said, "I swear that I'm innocent. I remain worthy of serving the army. Long live France. Long live the army." But it made no difference. Despite having pled his innocence, public opinion welcomed the verdict and wanted him to be sentenced. Dreyfus was used as symbolism for anti-Semitic propaganda, spreading popular opinion about the supposed disloyalty of French Jews. Not everyone was convinced, however, and doubt over Dreyfus's guilt spread like wildfire. The case sparked widespread public attention and split France apart into two opposing groups, those who were for his guilty sentence and those who were opposed to it. Dreyfus was eventually pardoned and released once it was realized that he was unjustly condemned, but not before spending over four long, brutal years on Devil's Island. Considering that more than 40% of prisoners did not survive their first year on the island, and few lived to see their release date, Dreyfus was very lucky. He was released on June 5, 1899. He had written a journal detailing his captivity in more than 1,000 letters. So how about those who managed to escape from Devil's Island prison? There are very few who succeeded, one allegedly being Clement Duval in 1901. He was an anarchist who fled to New York City and wrote a book about his imprisonment called Révolte. Another escapee was a man named René Belbenois, who escaped by helping a film company. He earned $100, which he used to bring a Chinese merchant boat to pick him up. When the boat arrived, he hid in it and sailed away. He spent months recovering with a native tribe off the mainland, making his way on foot through South America. He walked through Central America up to Mexico before finally entering the United States. Now, that's quite a hike. Belbenois published two books called Hell on Trial and Dry Guillotine, 15 Years Among the Living Dead, which spread awareness about what went on in the penal colony. There must have been something about the island that drove successful escapees into authorship. Why else would they want to recount their experiences by writing books about it? René Belbenois made a mistake by traveling back to his home country of France to argue his case. Upon his arrival, he was immediately captured and returned to the colony to be imprisoned once again. He was eventually released, though, and went on to live a free life in California, where he worked as a technical advisor for Warner Brothers during the making of the 1944 film Passage to Marseille. He also founded René's ranch store in the Lucerne Valley and later obtained legal U.S. citizenship in 1956. Perhaps the most popular and infamous escape from Devil's Island was done by Henri Charrière and Sylvain. Born in 1906, Henri Charrière was framed for murder and transported to the prison in 1930 from France. He was otherwise known as Papillon, the French word for butterfly. He earned his name due to the butterfly tattoo on his chest. During his escape, he leapt from a cliff on the island into the sea with his companion, Sylvain, using two sacks filled with coconuts as life buoys. It took the pair 3 days to drift to the mainland, and they somehow managed to avoid being eaten by sharks. Sylvain died shortly after reaching the shore, supposedly due to getting caught in quicksand. It must have been really aggravating for Sylvain to make it all the way across shark-infested waters for 3 days just to die that way. Henri, on the other hand, was caught and thrown into another prison, the Bagna at El Dorado, but was soon released to live a free life in Venezuela from there. After his ordeal was over, Henri wrote a book, Papillon, which detailed his experiences. French authorities attempted to discredit him, denying his claim that he had escaped from Devil's Island. They even went so far as to say Henri was never sentenced there to begin with. Critics go on to say that Henri should have admitted that this book was based on fiction. We'd be curious to know whether you believe Papillon is based on fabricated accounts of events or if French authorities were just trying to cover it up. It seems pretty suspicious to say the least, especially since many aspects of the story bear more than a few similarities to a memoir by another Devil's Island prisoner called Dry Guillotine, which had been written 30 years before Papillon. Nevertheless, Henri's Papillon name continued to live on in infamy upon his death in 1973. To this day, the name Papillon can be found carved in the floor of cell 47 on Devil's Island. There were even movie adaptations made from the story. If you're looking for something to watch tonight, there are two different versions of the film to choose from. We went ahead and did the research for you to make your life a little easier. The ratings on Rotten Tomatoes give an 83% for the 1973 version of the movie Papillon, starring Steve McQueen and Dustin Hoffman. A poorer score of 52% was given for the recent 2017 version of the film. You're welcome. Though the transportation of prisoners to the French penal colony was abolished in 1938, the last of the prisoners continued to remain on Devil's Island for much longer than that. The closure of the facility was delayed upon the outbreak of World War II. Starting in 1946, French penal colonies everywhere were gradually being terminated one by one. Devil's Island, however, was the last to shut its doors in 1953. For the most part, it was largely forgotten by the rest of the world. Today, however, Devil's Island is a popular tourist destination because of its dark past and the fame it acquired from the books and film adaptations of Papillon's story. There's a sort of twisted irony in the fact that so many prisoners could not flee the island in the past, but now you can't get on the island even if you wanted to. This is because it's closed to the public. Though you cannot actually step foot on the island itself, however, you can view it offshore from a charter boat. Many also take helicopters over it just to sneak an aerial peek at the ruins. The other two islands in the group, the three Salvation Islands, are open for access to the public and contain some of the original buildings restored as museums. So what's the appeal of visiting exactly? This may be in large part due to the movies, or perhaps some people have a ghoulish sense of curiosity for the atrocities that went on there. Who knows? Like with any story involving a place with a dark past, there are some who claim Devil's Island is haunted. Visitors have said they've seen ghosts of prisoners everywhere in the crumbling ruins. If we could ask, our question for the ghosts would be, if you died wanting to escape the island in life, why spend all your time there after death? Perhaps it's a form of purgatory for those lost spirits who still can't find their way to freedom. The year is 2000 and the date is December 13th. Seven men at a maximum security prison in Texas are just about to perform an audacious, if not brazen, prison escape. They are dangerous men, and between them are sentenced to hundreds of years. They are not prepared to do their time. In the words of the ringleader of the gang, George Rivas, "I had no parole, I had no good time, I had no incentive to behave. The minimum amount of time I had was 270 years and I obviously couldn't do that." He handpicked his team and what would follow is an escape and subsequent bloody crime spree. This is the story of the Texas Seven. Before we describe how these men managed to get out of maximum security prison and tell you about the horrors of what happened after they got out, let's first introduce the team. We have the ringleader, George Rivas, and you know he was never going to get out of prison. He was serving 18 consecutive 15-to-life sentences for robbery. That might seem like a lot of time for the crime, but he was convicted of aggravated kidnapping, aggravated robbery, and burglary. It's said he picked his team knowing he was more intelligent than them, but also because he knew they were dangerous men. Then we have Joseph Garcia, who was serving life for killing a man in a drunken altercation. Randy Halperin was doing time for badly beating a baby. He got 30 years. Larry Harper was serving 50 years for rape and acts of voyeurism. Patrick Murphy had 50 years to serve for aggravated assault, a particularly nasty crime against a woman. Donald Newbery was in for aggravated robbery with a deadly weapon. And Michael Rodriguez was serving 99 years to life for hiring a man to kill his wife. These are the Texas Seven. Rivas picked the team, and at some point the men began meeting at the John B. Connolly unit at the prison. Getting out of such a place was not going to be easy, and some believe the men hatched their plan over perhaps an entire year. On the day of the escape, just before lunch, the guards at the maintenance area sent the prisoners off for their chow. The guards then went for their lunch. Only Rivas, Garcia, Halperin, Harper, and Newbery were left in the maintenance area because they had managed to convince the maintenance supervisor that they had to wax the floors there. They told him that they would take lunch in this area. The supervisor said, fair enough, but he'd have to stay behind with them. Murphy, working in another area, asked to join the crew, and he was given the green light. As for the last of the group, Rodriguez, he managed to join the crew after lying to the guards that he had been told he had to pick up trash there. He wasn't initially part of the escape plan, but he became so. The men were all joined together just as they had planned. Then they had told the supervisor to follow them to a warehouse where they needed something. There, they got him down on the ground, stole his clothes, and left him tied up in a small electrical room. The crew found more clothes, but more importantly, they got the keys to the room where the tools were stored. In that room, they managed to get their hands on two hacksaws, a bolt cutter, wire cutting pliers, and a utility knife. Over the next 2 hours, they would get more clothes and the things they needed after subduing two prison guards as well as other inmates. Some of those hostages would get out of their restraints, but the gang would make sure they couldn't get out of the room that they'd been tied up in. With the clothes they'd stolen, the gang could now pretend to be supervisors, and that they did. They could also make sure the head count was right, although they were of course missing. Around this time, things could have gone wrong because one of the hostages in the room set the fire alarm off, but it was taken as a false alarm. The men in disguise then approached the gate where heavily armed guards were. They told the guards that they had a job to do, and that was to install video cameras. The guards let them through the gate and importantly did not ask for any ID. They came upon another guard at a gatehouse, and this one did ask for ID. But then the gang had been clever because they had left one guy in the maintenance department. That guy actually called the gatehouse to ask him if the men had turned up to install the video cameras. After this, the men subdued this guard and tied him up. Meanwhile, Halperin gained access to one of the towers, where an armed guard was stationed. Halperin later said in interviews that this guard had a lot of weapons on him, so he quickly lunged to grab one of his guns and pointed it at him. He then ordered the guard to open the vehicle gate. After that, he gained entrance to the armory, where he would take a lot of weapons from there. The stash of weapons included a 12-gauge Remington pump-action shotgun and 14 rounds of ammunition, 14 357 Magnum Smith & Wesson revolvers with a total of 210 rounds, and a .223 caliber AR-15 assault rifle with 15 rounds. Now, these guys were certainly very dangerous. The entire gang left the prison with all these weapons in a stolen truck. After they were well out of sight of the prison, one of the tied-up guards got loose and reported the escape. So now we have seven criminals with histories of violence let loose in Texas, and worse, they're armed to the teeth. The authorities put word out that very dangerous criminals were driving around and they were heavily armed. The manhunt was on, but nothing was going to be easy for the authorities. At the same time, the guards found three letters left by the gang, with some of those letters decrying the harsh conditions inside. One of the letters said, "You haven't heard the last of us yet." The authorities would take this as a threat, although the writer of that letter would later say that this was not the case at all. The men now have weapons, but they don't have much money. They do what they know best, and that's steal cash. At a Radio Shack store, they first take a look around, but then go back just before closing time. There are still some customers in there and four employees in total, all of whom are subdued. What's strange is the hostages said the gang were very friendly. Later in interviews, this gang said throughout the entire ordeal they tried their best not to hurt anyone, but as you'll see, that certainly did not happen. We should also state that during the hostage taking in the prison, people were held at knife point and also hit over the head or punched in the face. They stole thousands of dollars from the store, as well as electrical equipment, which included walkie-talkies and police scanners. The team then headed to Dallas, knowing full well that the police would think they were headed to the Mexican border. The group now had money, but they wanted more. On Christmas Eve, they decided to rob an Oshman Sporting Goods in Irving, Dallas County. They got to the store, bound and gagged the staff, and it said stole thousands of dollars as well as more than 40 different guns and lots of ammunition. But while this was going on, an employee was outside the store and he noticed something strange. He called the cops and 29-year-old police officer Aubrey Wright Hawkins turned up. Almost immediately, he came under fire. The officer was shot at different angles by perhaps three of the crew. Because they were firing from different sides of the car, at least one of the crew was hit. The officer was shot 11 times, with many of the bullets entering his head. He was then run over three times and left for dead. He actually died later in the hospital. The officer was married and had a son, and he was expected to celebrate Christmas with his family the next day. Later in an interview, his mother would say that his son said all he wanted for Christmas was his father back. The gang then fled in their motorhome, which was now packed with cash and guns. They'd even made a gun rack for their many weapons. They later parked this at a Christian community and posed as missionaries, saying they were doing the work of God. This was all a lie, except one of the men, Larry Harper, did attend Bible class and seemed to get into it. In interviews, the other people living on this kind of commune said the men seemed pretty normal, and Larry was welcome to the classes. But as time went by, the men couldn't hide. It was Rivas that was first spotted because someone noticed his face and the fact that he had a twitch. The police were called, but at first thought it just couldn't be the gang because there was no way they would have been stupid enough to stick together. Police soon knew they had their men and believed there could be one huge gunfight, but that didn't happen. First, Garcia, Rodriguez, and Rivas were arrested while driving around in a Jeep. After that, police went back to the park to get the other men, and there they found Halprin and Harper. The former gave himself up, but Harper put a gun to his head and killed himself. He left the Bible open next to him on a page about forgiveness. He also left a letter apologizing to his family and the Bible group he had deceived. The remaining two men, Newbery and Murphy, hid out through most of January and then told authorities that they'd hand themselves in if they could make a TV appearance. The authorities agreed, and the two men went on TV and denounced the criminal justice system. They said, "The system is as corrupt as we are." Newbery told the camera, "The way I see it is I had to make a statement. Our judicial system in the state of Texas has really gone to pits. We're receiving 99 years for a robbery for $68. Nobody injured." He said he'd been set up, that the evidence was flimsy at best, and he got 99 years. He added, "I've done the crime. You've got to face the music, but there's got to be something within reason in the state of Texas. They're giving kids so much time that they'll never get to see light again. Their life is gone. Now all they are is a roach in a cage." These words wouldn't save him. The authorities and the public had seen how these men killed a young father on Christmas Eve. People were furious. The men were sentenced to death. In 2008, Rodriguez was the first to go, having said he didn't want to appeal further. 2012, the ringleader Rivas was the next to go. Before he was executed, he said this to the family of the slain police officer, "I do apologize for everything that happened. Not because I'm here, but for closure in your hearts. I'm ready to go." Newbery was executed in 2015, and Garcia was executed in 2018. Halprin and Murphy are still in prison, with Murphy being the only one of the two who has an execution date. He's scheduled to die by lethal injection in November, so by the time you watch this show, that might already have happened. The case of Halprin has caused much controversy. He's been scheduled to be executed, but then his trial judge was accused of racial discrimination. Halprin is Jewish, and the judge was said to have used racial slurs against him and also said Jews need to be shut down because they control all the money. The Washington Post wrote that after that, Halprin's attorneys demanded a new trial. It got worse for the judge, according to the Post, because other people called him a lifelong racist who had vented anger on many occasions against lots of minorities in the USA. The newspaper wrote that this judge had even set up a trust fund for his kids that they would get on the condition of them marrying a straight, white, Christian person, spurring a lot of the American public to ask how this man became a judge. "With this in mind," asked Halprin's attorneys, "how could any non-Christian, non-white person receive a fair trial?" And that's where the story of the Texas Seven ends, for now. Some of you might have heard about a little island that lies just 1.25 miles off San Francisco. The only reason you've likely heard the name is because arguably the United States' most infamous prison was located there. The prison closed down, but tales keep being told. That prison had been home to some of America's most notorious criminals, and not for a second did the authorities think any of them could ever escape. That's because even if a prisoner did make it to the edge of the island, it was thought there was no way anyone could make it to land through the frigid and choppy water. The FBI believes that the only people that did ever get to the water died there. Full stop. Game over. It was impossible. But that might not be the case. Before we tell you about the recent revelations that might have proved the FBI were wrong all along, and indeed some men made it through the water and onto land, we think we should tell you about the escape itself. It's worthy of a movie, and that's why myriad movies have been made partly based on this brazen escape. The year is 1962. There have been 12 escape attempts before this year, and all of them failed. Not only did prisoners with escape in mind have to break out of their cells, but they had to scale high walls and get past armed guards. And then there was the dangerous waters of the San Francisco Bay. And as we said, the last hurdle was thought to be insurmountable. But four men this year weren't the type of guys to shy away from a challenge. Their names were Clarence Anglin, John Anglin, Alan West, and Frank Morris. And on June 11th, they made perhaps the most daring prison escape attempt ever. You'd be right in thinking that two of these men were related. They were actually brothers, and like the other two men, they were career criminals. We won't go into their backgrounds much, but it's important we give you a few details, as this might give you a clue as to how these men might have survived. For instance, the two Anglin brothers were said to be inseparable as kids, and from a young age, as early as 14, they were both toughing it out as laborers. After that, the duo decided that robbing banks was easier and less strain on the back, and the criminal career started. But the important thing we should mention is that both these guys, when just little kids, were said to enjoy swimming in Lake Michigan during the winter. It's said they impressed people around them by their incredible swimming ability, but also the fact that they could swim when there was still ice in the water. Another thing we should mention was the fact that Frank Morris was said to have a very high IQ. We aren't saying he was a genius, but an IQ of 133 isn't bad at all. So we have strength and we have brains, and it just so happened in 1961, these guys were placed in cells adjacent to each other. Now we see the plot thicken. It was Morris who was the brains of the operation, and he enlisted the two brothers who no doubt told him that surviving in the water would be a cinch. They did not wing their escape, however, and over 6 months devised and orchestrated their plan. What they knew they needed to do was widen the ventilation ducts in their respective cells. These ducts were too small for them to crawl into, and so with sharpened spoons and stolen saw blades, as well as a drill they had fashioned from a vacuum cleaner, they got to work. That was a noisy business, making the hole bigger, but the guards didn't hear a thing, as Morris spent most of the night playing his accordion. The guards weren't suspicious because they'd heard this sound before. The thing was, as the holes widened, it looked like a mess in the wall. So what the guys did was paint a piece of cardboard the exact same color as the wall and stick it over the hole in the daytime when they weren't working. You see, what these men knew is that when they got through the hole, they would hit a utility tunnel, a place far away from any guards. After a while, they could easily get into this tunnel, but that didn't mean they could just escape. Even though two of them were great swimmers, they knew swimming that distance at night would be hard or impossible, so they devised to make a raft. This took a few months, and the raft was made out of at least 50 raincoats that the men had stolen or other prisoners had given them. They also made paddles out of wood and bolts, and had life jackets. Those life jackets were also made out of raincoats, with the men using a process called vulcanization, a process to heat rubber to make the seam stick so that they could be blown up. It was the same for the raft. The men could make sure no air got out, and they could, in time, inflate it. But what we like the most is what the guys did to evade suspicion when they were in the tunnel working on the raft. They, of course, couldn't just go missing from their cells, so they made dummies. We've seen pictures of the heads, and they are unbelievably lifelike, considering what they had to work with. The heads were made from cement, skin-colored paint, and the best bit, human hair they'd collected from the prison barbers. It makes you wonder just how creative and industrious these men could have been had they not chosen a life of crime. It took about 6 months to get the raft finished. Now we have the problem of actually getting to the water. This got off to a bad start for West, because he'd used a kind of cement to keep his grill in place. What he hadn't reckoned on was the strength of this cement, and he couldn't even get his grill off on June 11th. He was left behind, and his confession is why we know so much about the escape. The other three men got into the tunnel, collected the raft and the rest of what they needed, and then they made their way to the roof. We're told from there they scaled down a kitchen vent pipe, which was around 50 feet high. They then climbed two fences, which were covered with barbed wire and were 12 feet high. It seems that they just used their strength, and 12 feet isn't too hard to climb. Now they were in a blind spot from the guards, and this is where they could inflate the raft. That's a lot of blowing for a pair of human lungs, but the guys had the concertina from Morris's accordion. That's the thing you push and pull that acts a bit like a human lung. The guards only realized the next day that the men were missing, and so the escapees had plenty of time to make it to land. The question is, did they make it? An investigation led to a paddle being found, but also bits of raincoat being discovered on the nearby Angel Island beach. Did this mean they got there, or just mean it had floated there? The FBI said that night the currents were really strong, and after many years of trying to find the men, they closed the investigation in 1979. The men had died. That was it. The end. But over the years, siblings of the two brothers would come forward and say they'd been contacted by their brothers. Countless other people would lead police on a wild goose chase, saying they were the escapees, or they'd been contacted by the men. It's said at one point the Anglin brothers might have attended a funeral of one of their older brothers, and there have even been sightings in Brazil. It's been called one of the greatest unsolved mysteries in American crime, and to this day, US Marshals say they still get leads as to where these guys are. But the fact is, there hasn't really been any substantial proof that the guys made it. Well, not until a recent bombshell hit the media. That's because in January 2013, the FBI received a letter they didn't tell the media about for a while. They decided to repress it, but they reopened the case. This is how the letter started. "My name is John Anglin. I escaped from Alcatraz in June 1962 with my brother Clarence and Frank Morris. I'm 83 years old and in bad shape. I have cancer. Yes, we all made it that night, but barely." The problem was that any DNA analysis was inconclusive, but still, something just rang true about the letter. The writer states that the brains of the group Morris died back in 2008. The writer was obviously one of the surviving brothers. This is what he told the police. "If you announce on TV that I'll be promised to first go to jail for no more than a year and get medical attention, I will write back to let you know exactly where I am. This is no joke." If the brothers did survive, now they would be in their late 80s. Morris would be 91, but he might have died if that letter is real. One thing to note, though, is that one FBI investigator who'd been with the agency for over 20 years told the media when the letter was released that just saying the raft failed and it was impossible to swim wasn't exactly conclusive. "We know these men could swim well, and these days we know many athletes can swim through that water and spend a long time in it. It's hardly an inhuman task to swim the San Francisco Bay." Then there's the fact that investigators say, well, we would have found them, they'd have committed other offenses. That's hardly convincing, too. The writer of the letter added that he had lived around the USA after the escape, and if the letter is real, it seems he did become a law-abiding citizen. That, or he just never got caught committing a crime. There's other stuff, too, such as what the nephew of the brothers said many years later. "My grandmother received roses for several years after the escape," he said to the media. That nephew added that the authorities should allow the writer of the letter to come in and let him be treated, but it seems the authorities had no interest in doing that. Well, the statement was released, so it seems there is some interest. The U.S. Marshals Service has not completely given up. It has publicly stated it will continue to pursue the escapees until they are either arrested, positively determined to be deceased, or reach the age of 99. Guantanamo Bay Naval Station is located on southeastern Cuba, a small 45-square-mile American military station on lease from Cuba since 1903. In the past, it's been an important naval station, ensuring U.S. military forces remain close to the Caribbean and its many vitally important trade routes. However, in 2002, the U.S. began construction of a detention camp where it would house suspected terrorists that had ensnared in its global war on terror. But just how secure is this facility? Hello and welcome to another episode of the Infographic Show. Today we're asking, is it possible to escape from Guantanamo Bay? The Guantanamo Bay Detention Camp, or Gitmo as it's commonly known, is a prison facility located on the U.S.'s Guantanamo Bay Naval Station. At the start of the U.S.'s War on Terror, a need for a secure housing facility for dangerous suspected terrorists and insurgents was immediately identified by the U.S. government, and thus construction began on what would be known as Camp X-Ray, which would later be shut down as Camp Delta. A 612-unit detention center came online. Camp Delta now houses Camps 1 through 6, as well as Camp Echo, where detainees are in-processed upon arrival. For 3 years, the CIA also operated a small site known as Penny Lane, which housed special prisoners the agency tried to recruit as spies. While the rest of the facility featured pretty sparse living quarters, Penny Lane had private kitchens, showers, televisions, and beds with mattresses, all in a bid to encourage prisoners to cooperate. Nearly from the start of operations, allegations of abuse and torture leaked to the press. Condemned by the United Nations, the U.S. argued that detainees at Gitmo were not guaranteed Geneva Convention rights and protections because they had specifically chosen not to fight as regular soldiers or operate under a clear chain of command. Terrorists and guerrilla fighters, the U.S. argued, were not protected by Geneva Conventions in place to protect uniformed prisoners of war. Men whose nations chose to abide by international law should be the only ones protected by that law. If allegations of torture weren't enough, however, Soon it was revealed to the public that most of the detainees couldn't be verified to have any actual links to terror organizations, and instead had simply been combatants arrested by NATO troops. Others had their links to terror networks greatly exaggerated, though a few were indeed some of the most dangerous men in the world. Because Guantanamo hosts some of the world's most dangerous terrorists, specific information about its security features are almost impossible to ascertain. However, we asked a security expert with 6 years' experience securing priority level 1 resources for the US government how a prisoner may, in fact, escape. Our expert, which asked to remain anonymous, said that escape was likely impossible, but every security has key vulnerabilities that can be defeated. The trick is being able to defeat all of a security system's vulnerabilities one after the other in the limited amount of time you have for an escape attempt, something which is simply not likely. First off, you're going to have to deal with the security personnel themselves. What is known about internal security at Gitmo is that military police personnel conduct constant rounds, making visual inspections of their prisoners every 3 minutes through a window on the cell door. Then there's the locking mechanism on the door itself, which is typically behind a half inch of steel and impossible to access. Simply put, you're not going to get out of your cell unless a guard lets you out. So your best chance for escape is to get friendly with a guard. If you're a particularly handsome man, trying to woo one of the female guards, approximately 20% of Guantanamo Bay's prison staff is female, you're going to be hard-pressed to get through all the anti-terrorist indoctrination. But hey, stranger things have happened. If that's not possible, though, and you somehow manage to compromise the locking mechanism on your door – our source wouldn't comment on how to do this – then you're going to have to deal with that pesky, constantly patrolling guard, checking in on you every 3 minutes. Luckily for you, though, our source states that the greatest vulnerability of any security system is always the human element. Guards become complacent, and while at the start of a shift, those 3-minute checks may come so punctually you could set your watch by them, but as the hours creep by, especially at night, 3-minute checks are going to turn into 4-minute checks, then 5 or 6-minute checks. Eventually, they may become even just hourly. Bigger security lapses have happened at facilities more sensitive than Gitmo. Complacency and time is your friend. Once you've figured out how to get out of your cell, simply wait. Be a model inmate, don't rile up the guards and lull them into a false sense of complacency. Wait for a popular holiday such as Thanksgiving or Christmas when guards will have more on their minds than just simply making some boring, repetitive rounds that they've made for months on end. That's when you make your escape. There are, however, bound to be additional security features inside the prison facility's housing units than just the door on the cell, and it's unlikely that you'll be able to defeat these without raising the alarm. One source tells us that because of its small size, Gitmo enjoys the benefits of smaller prison centers, better engineering and construction, which eliminates many of the pitfalls of larger complexes, such as the large access shafts that pierce through the heart of Alcatraz. Plus, the small size of the prison complex lets the guards enjoy a much better guard-to-prisoner ratio, which means more eyes on you than in a place with a larger population. Assuming you make it outside, however, you are almost certainly going to have to deal with several layers of security fencing. In most government facilities, video cameras ring the entire perimeter and are set up so each camera covers another's blind spot. A central alarm monitoring center will typically have one or two operators responsible for monitoring all interior and exterior alarms, and be able to instantly bring up any alarmed sector of the fence line on camera for a visual inspection. A persistent alarm, or if the camera is mysteriously down for some reason, will prompt them to send an armored patrol to make a physical sweep of the area. So how can you defeat multiple layers of alarmed fence line? Well, much the same way as you defeat the interior security – prey on human fallibility. Most secure facilities have 3 different types of sensors along their fences. The first is a Raycon microwave sensor that detects movement between the fence lines. The second is a taut wire sensor, which runs the length of the fence line and detects climbing or cutting. And the third is buried in the ground and designed to detect vibrations. That's 3 security features to overcome in the span of just a few minutes. How could you do it? Though the physical security system itself is formidable, it will always have one significant weakness – the human operators. Most security personnel will spend their entire career with 99.99% of every alarm and incident being a false alarm. This breeds a deep sense of complacency when training and professionalism dips amongst a security force. Some of the worst offenders, though, can be alarm operators themselves, whom typically spend countless hours pulling up alarms along the perimeter, which end up being nothing more than just a rabbit or mouse scurrying about. Add to that inclement weather, with winds pushing along debris and blowing on the fence line, and an alarm operator's board can light up like a Christmas tree. inevitably leading them to ignoring the majority of alarm calls for the duration of the storm, or simply accessing them and telling security personnel to conduct regular patrols through the area. Your task, therefore, is going to be to encourage an alarm operator to ignore the alarms he'll soon be setting off. This can be easily achieved, but will require greater patience, and will require the help of someone on the outside. Your secret collaborator will report to the planned escape route 2 weeks before your big escape, and camp out all night long outside the piece of fence line you'll be penetrating, while making sure they stay hidden from any security patrols. For 2 entire weeks, your compatriot will be tasked with setting off at least 2 of the 3 alarm systems on that piece of fence line, over and over again for hours on end every single night. This can be achieved relatively easily. You can do things like attach a thin fishing line to a piece of debris, such as a small stick, and hurl it over the fences to the other side. Then tug against the fences or drag it along the ground. This will set off the alarms, but when an alarm operator pulls up the video feed, they'll only see a piece of random debris. Alternatively, you can also use the same tactic used by American infiltrators during the Cold War against the Soviet secure facilities. Purchase a large amount of mice or other rodents, and every night release several into the fence line, one at a time over the course of hours. Seeing nothing but animals in the cameras after several days of this alarm, the operator will be inclined to simply begin ignoring new alarms from that sector. Repeat the procedure enough times, and chances are that the alarm operator will get sick of hearing the same alarm dozens of times night after night, and simply access it, silencing it, and ignoring it. Complacency is your greatest ally. Escaping from Guantanamo Bay is likely impossible, though, due to the physical security located inside the prison itself. Though ironically, the secure fencing is certainly the weakest element to overcome. Yet, even if you manage to make it to the outside of the prison, you'll still be amidst a U.S. naval station, and any escape will have to take into consideration the U.S. Navy's sea and air resources, to include patrol craft and helicopters. We might start with a positive. Not for the authorities, of course, and look at prison escapes that went marvelously right. We might remember one of the greatest escapes of all time, and that was because it involved 3 men breaking out of Alcatraz prison. They went missing in 1962, and still no one knows if they survived or died in the waters of San Francisco Bay. Then you have the final escape of Henri Charrière, aka Papillion, which involved sailing away on a makeshift raft. Or what about the numerous, incredibly cunning escapes of the serial killer scoundrel Charles Sabrage, a man who we've talked about already at length? More recently, we saw the brazen escape of the gangster Joaquin Guzman Larrea, aka El Chapo, but like many escapees, he was recaptured. Let's now look at failed escapes. The hapless hitcher. Obviously, once you've managed to escape from jail or prison, you should be careful who you talk to, as suspicion from another might land you right back in jail. In 2018, the BBC reported that 31-year-old Alan Lewis was being taken from Greenup County Detention Center in Kentucky, USA, when he told officers that his handcuffs were too tight and were hurting him. As an officer tried to help Lewis after a short struggle, he made a run for it. Freedom at last, but the man was stuck on a highway and needed a ride. In desperation, he held out his thumb, and a kind driver stopped for him. Except the driver noticed that Lewis was trying to hide what seemed like handcuffs fastened to one wrist. It turned out that the man driving the car was a police officer himself. Lewis got a ride right back to jail. The authorities later said he thought he was getting a ride, and he did. You might call this guy a chancer, but we'll get around to some hardcore criminals who orchestrated amazing escape attempts. An explosive letter writer. This is yet another failed prison attempt in 2018. This time it involved a man called Sean Damon Castorina, and he was trying to break out of Alamance County Detention Center in Graham, North Carolina. Serving time for first-degree murder, Castorina wouldn't have been released for quite some time, so he tried to figure out how he might get out a bit faster. His cunning plan to expedite his sentence was to build an explosive and blast his way out. Well, he needed help for that, so he wrote a letter to 2 of his friends with information about how to make a bomb and which prison wall they would blast, near to where Castorina would be waiting. What could possibly go wrong? Well, he sent that letter with bomb-making information to the wrong address, and it was picked up by a regular sort of person who subsequently informed the authorities. The media later wrote, "He has now been charged with 4 counts of felony conspiracy, 2 counts of manufacture or assemble a weapon of mass destruction, and 1 count of attempted escape from jail." Reading between the lines. Be careful what you say when planning a prison escape, even if you think your words are coded. In 2010, a 67-year-old prisoner at the Isle of Wight's Parker's Prison in the UK McKay thought he would send a message to the outside via a letter. In the letter, these words were written: "More heat, less light." It sounds innocuous, but guards that were monitoring all the prison mail became suspicious. It turned out that this former science teacher had been hatching a plot to escape from what some people have called the British version of Alcatraz. Seeing that the prisoner had written "more heat" in one letter, the guards heated up some of his correspondence. This revealed that he'd been using dried lemon juice to write down his escape plans. The heat showed he'd sketched detailed maps of the prison, while messages were conveyed using encrypted code and messages hidden in Sudoku puzzles. He was also planning to use a helicopter to pick him up in part of the prison where he could land. He was found out. Later, the prison governor said, "I'm delighted at the way our security team and Hampshire Constabulary have foiled a possible escape attempt." He was then moved to another prison, but reports state that none of his accomplices were arrested. Love won't tear us apart. This one should be a Hollywood movie, if it's not already and we don't know about it. It's the story of a woman called Barbara Ann Oswald. In 1978, she hijacked a helicopter that she had chartered, except she didn't count on the pilot being an ex-Vietnam vet. She put a gun to his head and told him to head to the United States Penitentiary, Marion in Illinois. She was trying to help inmate Garrett B. Trapnell, a con man, career criminal, and air pirate. Oswald was the lover of Trapnell, and the two had planned to get married. She didn't get very far as the pilot of the helicopter wrestled the gun from her and shot her in the head. That was the end of her and the end of the escape attempt. But the plot thickened. The daughter of Oswald was convinced that Trapnell was her father. He wasn't, and she very much wanted to get him out. She was only 17 years old when she hijacked TWA Flight 541 just months after her mother had died in the attempt to get Trapnell out. The brave daughter held the 80-something passengers for hours and flew to another location with about 40 passengers. She said she had dynamite strapped to her chest, but the three sticks turned out to be flares. She was finally arrested. Trapnell, who had hijacked a flight himself in the past, said there was no way that the young Oswald was his daughter. He'd never even met her mother face to face. Lord couldn't keep his mouth shut. Over in Australia, three hardened criminals who were all serving long sentences for drug trafficking got the idea to hire an SAS soldier living in the Philippines to get them out of prison in Melbourne. Except a man called Lord Tony Monaghan got in the way. Don't let the title Lord fool you. This man had once run a brothel. He had trafficked drugs himself, and he later grassed on others to reduce his own time in prison. One of the people he grassed on was the man known as Mr. Nice, aka Howard Marks, the Oxford-educated global pot trafficker who later became a celebrity of sorts. Anyway, so our Lord told the authorities that he had learned that three Aussies had hired an SAS guy to land on the tennis courts of the prison in a helicopter and break them out. He also said once they were dropped off, they would be taken in a van to Sydney and they would board a yacht and sail into the sunset. None of that happened, as the cops just waited for the men to wait on the tennis court and then arrested them during the escape attempt. Again, this could be a movie, and one of the guys who tried to escape had been featured in books. His name was David McMillan, another well-to-do Brit who speaks the Queen's English, but trafficked drugs for a living. He not only became one of the world's biggest smugglers, but he is the only man ever to have escaped from Thailand's notorious Klong Prim Central Prison. He wrote a book about this called Escape, saying because conditions were so brutal in Thai prisons, and the fact that he'd get death likely reduced to life, he had no choice but to get out early. The human stain. Okay, back to criminals we might not label with the epithet mastermind. In recent years, you can see that quite a few prisoners in Brazil have successfully escaped from prison by crawling into and out of the sewers. This can be a messy business, of course, but one can imagine the smell of feces can be put up with when the sweet smell of freedom is just around the corner. But back in 2016, things didn't go as planned for one fella. You can find a video of him online being pulled back out of a clogged sewer in what the media only said was a Sao Paulo prison. The video shows the captured man later standing in his cell, his skin painted brown, a coding the Telegraph newspaper called Human Filth. Current status: on the run. All of you out there know very well that if you were ever to successfully break out of jail or prison, then the next best thing is to probably keep your head down, right? We mean, you wouldn't post a photo on Facebook of your free face. No way. And you certainly wouldn't post a picture of your free head and not do anything about that globe icon that ensures anyone can see this picture. Well, CBS News in 2010 reported that a man called Chris Grego did just that, and he was warned by police. This one is perhaps a bit of a cheat, as Grego managed to evade cops before he was actually sentenced for assault, so it's more of an escape from law than a prison break. We just like the story. While Grego was out, he kept updating his Facebook page, and so the cops didn't have to try very hard to find him. Grego had even shown off, posting his own wanted poster on his page. One of the arresting officers told the press, "If it wasn't for criminals like him, our job would be a lot harder. Almost perfect, 9 out of 10. Sometimes we can be brilliant, and occasionally we just fall at the last hurdle. That's fine, at least we got to that hurdle. But in this case, you might wonder if the guy could have pushed himself just a little bit further." His name was Robert Emery, and he was locked up at Oregon State Prison in 2010. The Oregonian newspaper tells us that this hardworking man broke windows, drilled out a door lock, broke into metal tool cages, bashed a hole in the laundry well, lugged bags of tools, dug under one fence, and climbed over another. He'd also left a dummy in his cell, something we often see in movies. The media reports that he had spent time making this figure so it would look just like a real sleeping person. It had been a physically demanding night, and the news tells us that Emery wasn't just tired, but he was bleeding too. Emery, then 50 and serving time for robbery, kidnapping, and assault, after being hurt on the razor wire fence and then just decided to catch a few Z's, got under a blanket and went to sleep in the yard. Some reports, perhaps bordering on clickbait, state he fell asleep as he was just so tired. More responsible media, however, say he actually gave up as he could not scale the razor wire fence. Watch your weight. While you could argue that it isn't the worst prison in history of the world, the Tower of London evokes nightmarish pictures of bodies being torn apart on the rack, of hellish screams coming from dark chambers, of cruel leaders leaving anyone they disliked there irrespective of any crime being committed. But people escaped, and as late as the 20th century when a man picked a lock with a spoon. In the early 18th century, the Earl of Nithsdale dressed up as a woman and managed to get past guards. For that trickery, he saved his own head. In the 16th century, Jesuits John Gerard and John Arden performed the tried and tested rope over the wall thing and managed to lower themselves down to freedom. It's said that they did this with mangled hands, a punishment hors d'oeuvre before they were really hurt. But this is not a show about success, and we must tell you about Gruffydd ap Llywelyn, the son of a Welsh king back in the 12th and 13th centuries. He was imprisoned in the Tower of London after some disagreement with the King of England, with the latter not keeping his end of the bargain. It's said the king put Gruffydd up as a guest in the tower, but the Welshman wasn't keen on the idea. In 1244, he made a rope out of cloth and bits of sheets, and he tried to lower himself out of a window. His makeshift rope snapped. We're told he was a portly man, and he fell to his death. He and his gang robbed 24 banks and 4 police stations. He escaped from jail twice. The media portrayed him as a modern-day Robin Hood, and the public was enamored with him. His name was John Herbert Dillinger, and he was the world's greatest bank robber, a criminal agent so nefarious that his pursuit led J. Edgar Hoover to establish the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Hello and welcome to another episode of the Infographic Show. Today we're going to take a look at the brief life and times of the greatest bank robber in history, John Dillinger. John Herbert Dillinger was born June 22, 1903, in Indianapolis, Indiana. His father was a grocer and known to be a strict man who did not believe in sparing the rod for fear of spoiling the child. Sadly, little is known about his mother, as she died when Dillinger was only 3, and when his father remarried 6 years later, Dillinger intensely disliked his stepmother, although years later in his teens, he would begin a brief affair with her. As a kid, he was frequently in trouble and was known to be a bit of a bully. He eventually quit school and got a job in a machine shop, not an uncommon thing for pre-Depression-era youth to do in the United States. Known as a very smart young man, Dillinger excelled at his job, but his wild side inevitably got the better of him, and he began to stay out until all hours of the night. Worried that the city life was corrupting his son, Dillinger's father sold the family home and business and moved his family to a rural farm. Dillinger would not take well to living in the boonies, though, and the move to the countryside did a little to curb his wildness. At constant odds with his strict disciplinarian father, Dillinger eventually wound up stealing a car to go on a joyride and was caught by the police. In order to avoid legal trouble, though, and believing that a bit of military discipline would do wonders for the young Dillinger, the police agreed to release him if he enlisted in the U.S. military. Dillinger would go on to enlist in the U.S. Navy and put his engineering talents to use as a petty officer, third class, machinery repairman, aboard the battleship the USS Utah. He'd go on to be as poor a fit in the military as he'd been at home with his father, though, and after getting into trouble with his superior officers on several occasions, he eventually jumped ship while docked at Boston and deserted the Navy. A few months later, the Navy would officially dishonorably discharge him. Dillinger returned home to an angry father, but reconnected with an old flame and married 16-year-old Beryl Halvius in 1924. Determined to get out of their one-horse town and live in the big city, Dillinger and Halvius left home and moved to Indianapolis. Unfortunately, Dillinger had no luck finding any work in the city and eventually fell in with the wrong crowd, striking up a friendship with local pool shark Ed Singleton. The duo decided that the square life wasn't for them, and if society wouldn't let them have the good life they deserved, they'd just take it for themselves. The duo planned their first robbery together and decided to return to Mooresville, Dillinger's hometown, to rob a local grocer. The two were spotted by a local minister, though, who identified the men, and the duo was quickly arrested. His father took pity on the troubled young man and perhaps felt guilty for the way Dillinger had turned out, so he encouraged his son to plead guilty in hopes that such a plea would lead to leniency from the judge. Unfortunately, Dillinger's military desertion and previous arrest for Grand Theft Auto had strained his reputation, and the judge charged him with two joint sentences of 2 to 14 years for intent to rob and 10 to 20 years for conspiracy to commit a felony. Singleton, on the other hand, had pled guilty and only received a sentence of 2 years. Embittered by the harsh sentence and resentful of his father for encouraging him to plead guilty, Dillinger entered prison claiming that he would come out the meanest bastard you ever saw. While in prison, he would meet several prominent and experienced bank robbers, such as Harry Pete Pierpoint, Charles Mackley, Russell Clark, and Homer Van Meter, who all took the young Dillinger under their wing and taught him how to successfully plan and execute a bank robbery. The group of criminals also plotted future crimes they would commit together once released, adding not just to Dillinger's criminal ambitions, but his growing knowledge too. Meanwhile, Dillinger's father campaigned for years to have his son released, even getting a petition with 188 signatures, all attesting to the sweet, misunderstood angel his son really was. A judge eventually bought the claims, and Dillinger was released after 9.5 years. Unfortunately, he came home to a country in the grip of the Great Depression, and with no job prospects anywhere, it was only a matter of weeks before Dillinger returned back to his life of crime, robbing a bank in Bluffton, Ohio. Sadly, it seems, Dillinger hadn't learned nearly as much as he thought he had in prison, because he was quickly arrested by police on September 22, 1933, just 4 months after leaving prison. Housed in a local county jail to await trial, police discovered what seemed to be a prison escape plan while frisking Dillinger, though he denied any knowledge of such a plan. Days later, 8 of Dillinger's friends escaped prison using those same plans, with the help of shotguns and rifles that had somehow been smuggled into their cells. Not long after, 4 men showed up at the jail where Dillinger was being held and claimed to be prison staff who were there to take Dillinger to Indiana State Prison for violation of his parole. The suspicious sheriff asked to see the credentials, and one of the men pulled a gun and shot him, then beat the wounded man into unconsciousness. The men freed Dillinger and locked up the deputy and sheriff's wife into an adjacent cell as the sheriff bled to death on the floor in front of them. J. Edgar Hoover's nascent Federal Bureau of Investigation was contacted by local police who requested help in locating these very dangerous criminals. And while the feds began investigation that would lead to Dillinger's downfall, Dillinger, for his part, began his legendary crime spree. First, the men plundered police arsenals in Auburn, Indiana and Peru, Indiana, stealing several machine guns, rifles, revolvers, bulletproof vests, and ammunition. Then the men began a string of bank robberies across the state, raking in tens of thousands of dollars. During the crime spree, the Dillinger Gang, as it was now known, killed a police detective in Chicago, and a month later a police officer during a robbery of the First National Bank of East Chicago. With a lot of local heat building up in the area against the men, the gang decided to go south to Florida, and after a string of local robberies there, moved far west to Tucson, Arizona, always trying to keep one step ahead of the FBI and its agents. While in Tucson, though, a fire broke out on January 23, 1934 at the hotel where two of the gang members were hiding under assumed names. Firemen responding to the blaze recognized the men from their wanted posters and contacted the police, who promptly arrested them. The duo gave up the fact that Dillinger was also in the area, and shortly after, the police ambushed and arrested Dillinger and the fourth gang member as well. Police held Dillinger at the local county jail in Crown Point, Indiana, with the local police chief boasting that the jail was escape-proof, although extra guards were posted just in case another breakout by associates of Dillinger was attempted. On March 3, 1934, though Dillinger broke out of the escape-proof jail with the help of a wooden gun he claimed to have whittled inside his cell, others would say that the gun was made from a potato, while others yet claimed that a real gun had somehow been snuck into Dillinger's cell by a visitor. Whatever the truth, Dillinger was free once more, and grabbing two machine guns, he locked up the guards and fled once more. Unfortunately for Dillinger, though, he stole the sheriff's car and drove it across the Indiana-Illinois state line, resulting in a violation of the National Motor Vehicle Theft Act, which was a federal felony and drew the full attention of the FBI. Assisting local police up to this point, the FBI now had Dillinger fully in its sights, and the resulting chase would prove fatal in the end for the young career criminal. Dillinger returned to Chicago and joined up with several of his former prison mates, forming a fearsome gang that continued its pillaging of local banks. During this time, Dillinger lived with his girlfriend, Evelyn Frechette, in a small apartment, but on March 30, 1934, two FBI agents spoke to the manager of the apartment building after the man had reported two suspicious tenants. The FBI surveilled the apartment and suspected that the tenants, under the name of Mr. and Mrs. Hellman, were actually Dillinger and his girlfriend. The next day, a field agent and a police officer knocked on the door to Dillinger's apartment, and Evelyn Frechette answered, only to quickly slam it shut upon seeing the law enforcement officers at her doorstep. Police quickly surrounded the building, and during the siege, Dillinger's friend, Homer Van Meter, was shot and killed in a shootout with the cops. Under the cover of machine gun fire, though, Dillinger and his girlfriend escaped through a back door, Dillinger having suffered a gunshot wound during the escape. Dillinger and Evelyn fled to Mooresville, Indiana, where the duo stayed with his father until his wound healed. His father, perhaps overcome with fatherly devotion, kept the two's location secret from law enforcement. Evelyn eventually left to go to Chicago and visit a friend, but was immediately arrested by the FBI upon arrival. Not shedding many tears for his criminal love bug, Dillinger, now fully healed, left home and robbed the police station in Warsaw, Indiana, of its guns and bulletproof vests. Dillinger then moved to Upper Michigan, narrowly avoiding a posse of FBI agents that had been sent to Warsaw by plane. A few days later, though, the FBI task force received a tip that men resembling Dillinger and his longtime accomplice, Babyface Nelson, had checked into the summer resort of Little Bohemia Lodge in Wisconsin. Under the cover of darkness, FBI agents make their way up to the lodge and turn off their vehicle lights as they get within 2 miles of the resort. The agents take off into the woods and close the remaining distance on foot, determined to not let Dillinger out of this trap. Unfortunately, as they got near, machine gun fire rained down on the men from the roof, and the agents desperately called for backup, but to no avail. Dillinger once more had escaped and evaded law enforcement. 2 months later, though, a woman named Anna Sage, madam of a local brothel in Gary, Indiana, contacted the FBI. She claimed that Dillinger was staying in her brothel and offered to turn him in exchange for a cash reward and for help in fighting her deportation, as she was scheduled for removal to her native Romania. The FBI agreed to the cash reward and to lend what help they could in her deportation. And for her part, Anna Sage informed the agents of Dillinger's exact whereabouts, even going so far as telling them his plans for the following Sunday night. On Sunday, July 22nd, FBI agents waited in ambush as Dillinger exited a local theater. Walking with two female companions at his side, an agent waiting in a doorway lit a cigar as a signal, and suddenly, FBI men swarmed the alley Dillinger was walking down. Realizing what was going on, Dillinger pulled out a pistol as he tried to run away, but three bullets found their mark, and Dillinger fell to the pavement. Just 20 minutes later, the infamous bank robber would be pronounced dead. John Dillinger was famously portrayed as Robin Hood character by the media, and he and his gang frequently gave interviews to local papers. While he was charged in at least one homicide, Dillinger was adamant his entire life that he had never and would never shoot anyone, using his pistol for its fear value rather than its killing potential. Whatever the case, Dillinger's life of crime inevitably caught up with him, and like so many other criminals before him, would lead to nothing more than laying dead on the cold pavement. "We go tonight" is often the dramatic movie line you hear in the prison escape epic, but in the case of escapes, fiction doesn't need to embellish hard facts. It's some endeavor for the prisoner to break out of a cell, go over a wall, dig tunnels under the ground, sometimes tie up a guard, and for the criminal with some cash behind him, perhaps get a helicopter out of there. We've already told you about possibly the only escape from the notorious prison of Alcatraz, of El Chapo's escape tunnel, and we've gone over some pretty terrible failed escapes. But what we have for you today, we can say, are some of the most ingenious prison escapes on record. Number 9. Explosive fruit. In 1996, the New York Times reported that a man who had been serving an 18-year sentence in France for armed robbery managed to escape from prison. This was a 34-year-old called Michel Vujou who had previously escaped from prison in France three times. This escape was said to be his most brazen, worthy of a trophy if they were awarded for such criminal activity. It was reported that Vujou flew away in a helicopter with a woman who it was later said was his wife and who had been taking flying lessons in preparation for the escape. What the Times didn't say was that to get to the roof, Vujou had an ingenious way of getting past guards. He was holding grenades and threatening to throw them at anyone who got in his way, except those grenades, according to CNN, were nectarines that he had earlier painted to look like grenades. CNN said that he was later captured, but then says he ended up doing another bank robbery only to be shot in the head and survive. We're not sure where he is right now, but it seems he's written a book and is a free man. Number 8. More food stuff. Prior to this 2015 escape, no one had ever escaped from the maximum security Clinton Correctional Facility in Dannemora, New York. At around 5 a.m., guards discovered that two men were missing from their cells, and they were the convicted murderers Richard Matt and David Sweat. It was soon found out that these men had painstakingly made a tunnel whose ending, called an external breach, was 500 feet outside the prison walls. This would of course take some doing with a spoon, but it's said the men managed to get a hold of tools from contractors inside the prison. Those tunnels were partially already made, but still a lot of digging, breaking, and cutting had to be done. The New York Times said that the men first had to cut through the cell, and for that they used a hacksaw. A prison tailor later admitted he'd been smuggling in blades hidden inside frozen hamburger meat. The escape had been compared to the one in the movie The Shawshank Redemption, but it ended badly after a massive manhunt resulted in Matt being shot and killed by US Border Patrol and Sweat being shot and then sent back to prison. Number 7. Tight fit. This is the story of a man nicknamed the Korean Houdini, and we very much doubt anyone will ever repeat what he did to get out of prison. That's because he didn't require any fancy tools, helicopters, or weapons. He just needed to lose a bit of weight and become more flexible. On the day of his escape in 2012, he covered himself in a kind of gel and then proceeded to squeeze his body through a 15-centimeter high, 45-centimeter wide food slot. Take a moment, please, to imagine what that might have looked like. The police at the detention center in Daegu Police Station in Korea were rightly stumped. It was only when they looked at surveillance footage that they saw the 165-centimeter, 114-pound man slipping through the small hole that they knew how he had gotten away. The man was said to be very flexible because during the 23 years he'd been incarcerated during his life, he had been practicing yoga and had become a master. He was recaptured anyway a few weeks later. The Korean authorities later told the press that they had now given him a cell with a smaller food slot. Number 6. The Studious Serial Killer. There's no doubt you've all heard of Ted Bundy, perhaps one of the most demented and violent serial killers in American history. What you might not know is that he escaped from cells twice during his incarceration in the 1970s. The first time was perhaps the most ingenious, with Bundy telling authorities he needed to study law as he was representing himself. He'd already studied law as a free man, but during a court trial he said he needed to read up on something. He was given access to the library during recess, and as he wasn't wearing restraints because he was both lawyer and prisoner, he went to that library unimpeded. He then jumped out of a second-story window and went on the run. He was recaptured, but then, when imprisoned at a later date, he used books again to escape. This time, he simply got through the jailhouse roof and then left books under his blanket so guards would think it was him sleeping. According to Bundy, one of the most educated serial killers we've seen, escaping was easy. This is what he said to a prison psychologist on the telephone. "Over the months, I had noticed a number of opportunities to just walk right out. I'd thought a great deal about escape, and I didn't know if I had the guts to do it, quite frankly." Number 5. A Simple Plan. This next one might sound simple, but it took guts, and you could say there was genius in the simplicity. The escapee was called Charles Victor Thompson, and he'd been sentenced to death for murdering his girlfriend in 1998. During his time behind bars, he conceived of a simple plan, and that was to walk right out of prison. For this, he first had to smuggle in ordinary clothes. And in 2005, he arranged a meeting with his lawyer. Apparently, at one point, the lawyer left the room, and then Thompson got into his civilian clothes. He opened the door and started walking, and then after that, he said he just later walked anywhere he could find open doors until he found himself next to a door that led to freedom. He didn't last long on the outside, however, and while he was sheltered and fed because he was pretending to be a Hurricane Katrina evacuee, the cops got him after he made a drunken phone call. He's now back in prison and has written a couple of books. Oh, and to this day, no one knows where he got the handcuff key from, and Thompson doesn't want to tell. Number 4. The Escape Artist. Here we have a notorious British criminal with quite a brain, and that's because not only did he break out of prisons 3 times, but he learned law while inside and represented himself. His name was Alfie Hines, and he was to serve a 12-year stint for armed robbery in the 1950s. During one of those escapes, he'd gotten fellow inmates to do some work on a toilet door. And that meant attaching metal screw eyes to the door. When Hines asked to go to the toilet, he was escorted by 2 officers. But then Hines pushed the officers into a toilet and attached a padlock he'd earlier smuggled into the screw eyes. His freedom lasted all but 5 hours. Nonetheless, after escaping another 2 times, he was eventually given a pardon for his crimes because of his vast knowledge of the British legal system. After that, he acquired celebrity status in the UK. Number 3. A sticky situation. The BBC reported in 2017 that a whole bunch of inmates had escaped from an Alabama prison after tricking a guard with peanut butter. The article tells us that the inmates were well aware that one of the guards was new and perhaps didn't know his way around very well. It said the prisoners used peanut butter to cover up a number on an exit door. In a statement, the sheriff's office explained exactly what happened. That statement read, "The inmates took advantage of a new guard by using peanut butter to conceal an exit door number. When the inmates called for the guard to open the door and let them in the cell, the guard inadvertently opened the exit door." The BBC, having fun with this one, wrote, "It was not clear which variety of the paste was used by the prisoners, or whether it was crunchy or smooth." The US authorities did say the men were clever, but they weren't that clever, because they were all rearrested shortly after tasting freedom. Number 2. The Transvestite. The year was 2012, a year when a drug trafficker from Brazil decided he didn't want to spend any more time behind locked doors. His name is Ronaldo Silva, and during a visit with his wife, he just walked out of the prison. We're not sure what happened to the wife. What he had done was switch clothes with his loved one while she was visiting him. He then put on some lipstick that she had brought in and also donned a woman's wig and some high heels. Prior to this, we should say that he had a very close shave. He apparently got out of the prison, but someone later told police that a strange-looking man, not walking very well, was hanging around a bus stop. Police then arrested him. You can see the photos online of how he looked dressed as a woman. And you might agree with us that it's frankly amazing he got 1 foot out of the visiting room. Number 1. Mass Escape from the Maze. This might be the biggest prison escape in history, but if not, it's certainly the biggest in terms of numbers that the UK has ever seen. That's because 35 prisoners got out. It was in 1983, and this group all belonged to the Irish Republican Army. They made it out of a prison in Belfast, Northern Ireland called Maze. We won't call it too ingenious, as it took some amount of violence to escape, but 35 nonetheless is a big number when we consider the facility was maximum security. With knives and smuggled guns, the group of inmates demanded that the officers they had hostage give them their clothes and car keys, and that they did under duress. An alarm was raised and there was mayhem in the prison, but with hostages it was a tricky situation. Later, the inmates got hold of a food truck and tried to drive it out of the gates, with some of the inmates dressed in officers' uniforms and so causing confusion. The officers blocked the gates with their cars, and so the men got out and proceeded on foot. Officers were shot and stabbed during this ordeal, and one man died. Others were very seriously injured. 38 were in the escape gang, but 3 didn't make it out. It was called the biggest prison escape in Europe since World War II. 15 men were recaptured that same day, and another 3 soon after. What happened to the rest is a long story, but some were killed, some were sent back to prison, and some were extradited from the USA. Out of the 38 that tried to get out that day, after many years, only 2 men have evaded arrest or being killed. The year was 1953, and British criminal Alfred George Hines was serving 12 years in prison, but the Nottingham prison where he was held wouldn't be able to contain him, as he eventually got through locked doors and climbed a 20-foot wall to freedom. He spent almost a year across Europe before being recaptured, and then quickly escaped while awaiting trial and headed straight for the airport. He was caught again, but escaped from Chelmsford Prison and fled to Ireland, where his freedom lasted 2 years. He became notorious in the British media, dubbed Houdini Hines, and was inducted into Mensa after his eventual release from prison. Many people consider him the greatest prison escape artist of all time. This video is not about people like him. There are around 2,000 prison escapes each year in the United States, but that number is dwarfed by the number of escape attempts. Most of these are foiled very quickly, and most never even get off the grounds of the prison. Common tactics for escaping prison include trying to scale the prison walls, running into the nearby woods, or attempting to get smuggled out of the prison. Guards know how to look out for these tactics by now, and uncreative inmates usually find themselves right back where they started, maybe with a longer sentence or less comfortable quarters. Other inmates are taking a more aggressive approach and starting riots or taking guards hostage. Those usually end in a standoff and hostage negotiation that's highly unlikely to end with release. But some inmates take more creative approaches to escape. We said creative, not effective. Kenneth Burnham was doing a few years in prison for burglary when he started to get stir-crazy. He watched other inmates in his Hamilton County, Tennessee prison get prepped for release and thought, why not me? Then he took that a bit too literally. As another inmate was about to be released on bond awaiting trial, Burnham took advantage of the light security and decided he'd simply take that man's identity. He presented himself when the officers came to collect the lucky inmate and signed all the paperwork. He was just minutes away from freedom. There was just one problem. The inmate set for release, Glenn Taylor, was black, and Burnham was definitely not black. Prison officials looked on the sheet and saw the issue, and Burnham's not-so-great escape was stopped in its tracks. Burnham briefly claimed to have not been aware Taylor was black, but admitted he just wanted to escape. He wound up being charged with criminal impersonation and attempted escape, ensuring he'd have a bit longer to cook up half-baked escape attempts. At least he stayed clean, unlike our next inept inmate. Everyone remembers the famous prison escape from the Shawshank Redemption, as innocent lifer Andy Dufresne tirelessly tunneled his way out of his cell and escaped through the prison's sewer system. But fact isn't as glamorous as fiction, as one Brazilian inmate found out. He tunneled out of his cell into the sewer system too, but he wasn't all that well prepared. He decided to make his escape wearing only a pair of shorts. Not ideal wear for digging around through human waste to make your escape. At least the sewer's a clear shot to freedom, right? Wrong. From the moment the unfortunate prisoner decided to make his escape, it was nothing but one humiliation after another. He got stuck in the sewer only a few feet from his cell, lost his shorts in the sewer, and had to be pulled to safety covered in filth and completely naked by two other men. The man's ill-advised escape attempt was caught on video that went viral around the world, but his name was never released to the public and no one knows what became of him. He's probably happy about that. It's hard to keep cool in prison, but one inmate took impatience to another level. Andrew Wilson seemed to be a model prisoner, doing time for burglary, theft, and possession of controlled substances. He had to keep his nose clean in prison and was approaching his parole board hearing. All he had to do was stay calm and do his work detail. Wilson wasn't considered a high-risk inmate, so he was given a little more freedom, which one day he decided to take full advantage of. He stole a truck at the work camp he was serving at, drove off, and ditched the truck to run to freedom in the next town. He tried to stay ahead of the authorities, but it wasn't long before he was caught, with drugs on his person. He was facing new charges of possession and escape from custody, and would be extending his stay in Tennessee's Corrections Department. But he did get one piece of good news when he was back in custody. The parole department had approved his release only 24 hours after he escaped. Patience is a virtue, but not for Andrew Wilson. Making an escape from prison is hard enough. Staying free is even harder. One inmate found that out the hard way. The Olympic Correction Center in Washington was a relatively easy prison to escape from, and James Russell was no rookie. He was serving his fourth prison term and had just been transferred to the minimum security work camp. It didn't take long for the serial thief to take full advantage, as he made a break for it and escaped into the nearby woods. But he was in a rural area, still wearing his prison gear, and needed some help to make his escape complete. He came across a cabin at a nearby river resort and decided to sneak in. Sounds like a smart plan. Not like anyone would recognize him. There was just one problem. The current resident of the cabin was a guard at that exact prison that Russell had escaped from. Seeing an escaped inmate, the guard immediately tackled Russell. Russell escaped, but the guard notified all the other guards in the area to be on the lookout. Russell was quickly tracked down by the other guards, facing new charges for escape. The serial offender's brief stay in minimum security was over. Most prison escapees are hardened criminals, right? Not quite. Christopher Boscacci had only arrived at Elmwood Correctional Facility a few days earlier, but he was quickly getting tired of prison life. It was time to get out of there, and he made a break for it. Boscacci was actually much better at escape than most inmates, and the guards were taken by surprise at just how fast he made it over the fences. But he wasn't prepared for just how many fences there were, and after leaving his shoe atop the barbed wire, he was eventually snagged before scaling the last fence. What terrible fate was Boscacci fleeing? The hardened criminal doing hard time was actually facing misdemeanor petty theft charges, and he was staying in a minimum security facility while awaiting arraignment. By making a break for it, he traded his relatively comfortable digs for a stay in maximum security and felony charges that would likely see him staying in the prison system for several years instead of a short stay in county jail or probation. Most prisoners who fail at their escapes just head right back to where they left, but some aren't so lucky. Prison escapes have been going on far longer than the modern prison system, and old-time prisons could be very tricky to escape. What they lacked in modern security, they made up for in treacherous designs that threatened any escapee with certain death. That didn't stop Gruffydd ap Llywelyn, a Welsh king in 1244. He had been held in prison for much of his life due to conflicts over his father's land, and he was eventually held in the notorious Tower of London by his brother Dafydd in a particularly nasty family feud. He had enough, and he hatched a dangerous plot. He designed himself an improvised rope made from his bedsheets and threw them out the window, planning to scale the Tower of London and rappel down. There was only one problem. All those years in captivity weren't great for exercise, and Gruffydd's weight was too much for the thin cloth to handle. He did make it down from the Tower of London, but at a much faster speed than he was hoping. Gruffydd wasn't the only famous prisoner to try and fail to escape, and the next one shows that higher education is no guarantee of strategic smarts. Dr. Samuel Mudd might have simply been in the wrong place at the wrong time, treating the injured John Wilkes Booth after the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, but his participation in lying to authorities got him a life sentence in prison. He was imprisoned on the isolated Fort Jefferson, and prisoners had a bit more freedom there since they couldn't get off the grounds easily. Mudd befriended Henry Kelly, a teenager working on the transport steamer, and convinced the boy to smuggle him off the island. Mudd changed into professional-looking clothes, snuck into Kelly's ship, and tried to blend in. There was just one problem. He was probably the most famous convict in the country at the moment. He was soon identified by the fort's storekeeper, arrested, and sentenced to hard labor. Kelly also found himself in trouble for participating in the escape plot, but Mudd's story had a happier ending than most failed prison escapees. He was pardoned by President Andrew Johnson and headed home after only a few years. Getting help is a good way to get out of prison, but the partner in crime doesn't always work out. Michael Coleman and Lester Burns were tired of their stay in prison, and when the opportunity presented itself, they made their escape. They were on a long trip in a prison van along with other inmates when they had to make an emergency stop due to a prisoner's medical issue. When the guards were in the hospital with the sick inmate, the inmates were left in the van, and five of them watched in shock as Coleman and Burns jumped back into the van and drove it off. There was just one problem. Oklahoma inmate Joshua Silverman wanted no part of this, and when Coleman and Burns stopped the van briefly, he called 911 and let the authorities know exactly where they were. He knew the penalty for an escape attempt and wanted to play it safe, and soon the authorities were all over the area tracking down the inmates one by one. Coleman and Burns were foiled because not everyone they drafted into their escape was on board. Some inmates go further than most to escape, and this next one even got his family involved. Clavino da Silva was a notorious drug trafficker in Brazil, and he was serving a sentence of more than 70 years when he hatched his escape plan. One of the few people who still visited him on the inside was his 19-year-old daughter, and when she arrived, he convinced her to help him. When the daughter left the prison after her visit, everyone noticed she looked a little different, and it didn't take long for the ruse to unravel. It was Clavino da Silva dressed up as his own daughter, and he was less than convincing. A tight pink t-shirt and a rubber mask that made him look like a cartoon character weren't fooling anyone. Making it worse, he had left his daughter behind to serve his sentence. He wound up back in prison, and his daughter found herself facing criminal charges for abetting an escape. One of Brazil's great criminal masterminds found his skills deserting him when it came to getting out of prison. Sometimes all it takes is one error to make a great prison escape fall apart, as our last inmate found out. There was no escaping from the most notorious prison in American history, Alcatraz Island. It had one unique security feature, the raging waters off the coast, which made swimming to shore all but impossible. But that didn't stop inmates from trying, and all 14 escape attempts were foiled, except for five men who were never found. Only one man ever got to shore from Alcatraz Island. His name was John Paul Scott, and he would have been a legend if it wasn't for one major misstep. A bank robber doing 30 years, he was sent to Alcatraz in 1949 and served 13 years before making his move. He snuck out using a rope while on culinary duty and left his injured partner in crime behind. He swam all the way to Little Alcatraz, a nearby rock formation, making him the only person to survive the waters without being captured. There was only one problem. He was completely exhausted and collapsed on the rock, where he was picked up soon after. Was it possible to escape from Alcatraz? Not for long. When most people think of prisons, they think of some place they're happy not to be. But not everyone. While we often hear of inmates trying to break out of jail to freedom, there are also some who try to break in for any of several reasons. Depending on their unique circumstances, they face different consequences for their actions. Let's find out what these could be in this episode of the Infographic Show. What happens if you break into prison? First of all, just what happens to you if you either attempt to or successfully break into a prison largely depends on who you are, your motivations, and what you did if you were lucky enough to make it in. Applicable laws may vary by state, not to mention by country. To find out what these consequences could be, let's look at some of the unlucky who have attempted to navigate a jail's defenses only to be caught and, in most cases, charged and sentenced. Sylvester Giles, for example, had formerly served time for manslaughter but was released from a Florida jail in 2009. He lasted 3 days in the great wide open before apparently missing the feeling of being boxed in. He first approached guards with a simple request to let him back inside. They obviously refused, after which he attempted to climb over the jail's walls. He may or may not have noticed the barbed wire on top before his climb, but it's safe to say he was well aware of it after. He got stuck in it and was caught. Because he was out on probation, in this instance he was in violation of his probation conditions and was sentenced to 15 more years in prison. While most would find this terrible news, we're sure he was quite oddly thrilled. Then there's Martin Ussery, who, like Sylvester Giles, apparently didn't like being free. Though instead of lasting 3 days outside bars, at least he made it to 3 years. After being paroled from Folsom Prison in California in 2008, he was found in the grass outside the facility in 2011. His location was given away due to handy thermal technology, which zeroed in on him as he climbed a fence. In this crazy world of crazies, we can almost believe his claims that he was just there to reminisce about his previous stay. However, it's much more likely that he was there in an attempt to smuggle in contraband instead. Unsurprisingly, he was charged and his bail was set at an impressive $1 million. Let's hope for his sake that any cash he made in his efforts to sneak things in amounted to anything close to that amount. In the case of Monique Armstrong, who was not out on parole, what she lacked in criminal history she made up for with limitless stupidity. Believe it or not, she actually called the police before attempting to gain unauthorized entry into a Colorado facility. She was able to navigate a chained fence and was trying to break windows to a building when she was spotted. All this was an attempt to get access to her 18-year-old brother, who was not even in that area of the property. She asked to be arrested, and those in charge were all too happy to oblige. This behavior earned her charges of criminal trespass and criminal mischief. Her brother, on the other hand, who'd she gotten into all this mess in order to see, walked out just hours later on bond. We're guessing he had better sense and didn't break back in to see his silly sister, though that would make a great story. Then there were those willing to put their freedom on the line for friends and family. Patrick Rempe of Florida, for instance, was arrested after he got tangled in the wire of a prison fence, though it was almost certain he'd been caught regardless. If you're curious why, we'll tell you. You see, before he started to climb the fence, he'd announced his presence by driving his car into the prison's front door. It seems that Rempe was high at the time on a drug known as Flaca and just wanted to visit his buddies. This was somewhat of a problem, however, since they were prison inmates. He decided to pop in nonetheless, though he really didn't think it through as he couldn't navigate even one fence and the prison had two. Beyond these, there was also the issue of a locked door. Now, what does driving high, crashing your car into a jail, scaling its fence, and fighting back when you get caught get you? Three felonies for criminal mischief, driving under the influence, and leaving the scene of a crash with property damage. Not to mention aggravated assault and battery on a law enforcement officer. In other words, it was really, really not pretty. Facing these charges, he was held without bond, but fortunately for him, this meant lots of opportunity to catch up with those friends. There seem to be fewer charges involved for those who attempt to bust into jail while intoxicated when they don't first crash their cars, destroy prison ground property, or fight the police. Tiffany Hurd, for example, faced only one charge in the case of drunkenly attempting to enter the Butler County Jail in Ohio. She was yet another who was stopped short by a rather inconvenient fence. Again, like Monique Armstrong, she rather strangely requested to be arrested when found. This was in spite of the deputy present repeatedly trying to convince her to go home. It seems that not only breaking into prison but requesting to be thrown into jail happens more often than you'd think. Booze or not, due to her strange behavior, she was given the misdemeanor charge of disorderly conduct. Let's hope she didn't make her situation worse with a repeat offense by attempting to drink away her new problems. Nicholas Celius of New Orleans tried to infiltrate the recreation area of a jail in 2018 for much more nefarious reasons. He was noticed but escaped only to abandon his backpack, which was holding quite an impressive stash of cocaine, marijuana, and heroin. He was captured not long after. In addition to resisting an officer, he faced charges of drug possession. And then there was the matter of an outstanding warrant from the state of Texas. While Celius had been nabbed, however, two others on the scene were not as easy for the cops to pick up. At the time of his arrest, these accomplices remained at large as well as unidentified. Then we have a strange case involving some alcohol in the country down under of Australia. Apparently it was here that in the summer of 2014, detainees were leaving its Berrima jail and then turning around and re-entering. While free, they would go out and have some fun drinking. However, they made sure to return each and every day before prisoners were accounted for first thing in the morning. Unfortunately for those involved, their activities were revealed when some of the men brought attention to themselves by fighting over a cellular phone. This left authorities in quite a confusing position as they tried to figure out what charges they could level on the offenders for breaking out but then breaking back in. Believe it or not, we have an even odder situation involving a planned break-in in Queensland, Australia. Here, two young women in their 20s went to a restricted area outside of a Brisbane correctional facility and stood suspiciously by its fence. They were discovered, and the reason they gave for their actions defies all logical reason. Apparently, the women had watched far too many episodes of a popular crime-based drama called Wentworth, and they wanted to know if a real-life prison was interesting. Though searched and found to have nothing suspicious on them, they still faced charges of unlawful entry. The event inspired a police officer to remind the public that correctional institutions are serious places and not tourist destinations. For Sarai Vlasenko, his reasons for crawling under the fence of a prison made much more sense and, as far as we can tell, got him no consequences. Then again, he was a lawyer representing a former Ukrainian prime minister who was supposedly being denied satisfactory health care behind bars. In addition to allegedly skimping on medical treatment, they must have also been trying to save money with limited guards. When Vlasenko arrived, there was no one there to let him in, or as others believe, they were purposefully denying him entry, with a rather peculiarly timed break. Whatever the reason, Vlasenko was less than patient. Without anyone to give him access, the lawyer resorted to a rather unlawyer-like behavior by entering via the bottom of the fence. The chief of the prison labeled this as voluntary trespassing. Vlasenko, on the other hand, claimed that to see his client, such actions were necessary. Though he may have escaped punishment in this instance, the lawyer ultimately got hit with other legal issues involving a messy divorce and alleged theft. So aside from obvious amusement, what can we take away from all of these unique situations? Well, it appears at the very least that someone attempting to bust into jail will be leveled with some type of charge for trespassing. If they're drunk or high when they do it, they can be charged with disorderly conduct, or in the unusual instance where it's applicable, driving under the influence. Doing things like attempting to break windows can get you hammered with an additional charge of criminal mischief. If breaking in to sell illicit substances, you can add drug possession to the list. And of course, failure to cooperate once identified never goes over well, and you can be accused of assault and battery on an officer or attempt to resist. If out on parole, you can expect to land right back behind the bars that you came from. Fortunately for all involved, there's nothing technically criminal about being silly or downright stupid. And not that you should need such a warning, but as these stories show, if you try to break into a jail, there are many reasons why you likely won't succeed or get very far. In the case of Nicholas Celius, for instance, the jail he attempted to breach had more than 800 cameras on hand. With such thorough surveillance, he really didn't stand a chance. Then let's not forget the formidable prison ground fencing. Its wire snagged Sylvester Giles, Patrick Rempe, and Tiffany Hurd, among others who would otherwise have successfully entered. Then there's things like locked doors, shatterproof windows, and thermal imaging technology that work against potential intruders. Of course, in addition to these things, there are many other security measures in place. And if you call the police beforehand or drive your car into the prison, you have pretty much zero chance of evading detection. Just when we thought criminals couldn't be any stupider, they'd never cease to amaze us. Do you have any fun prison break-in stories that we didn't cover that you'd like to share? Let us know in the comments. Also, be sure to check out our other video called Last 24 Hours of a Death Row Inmate. Thanks for watching, and as always, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. See you next time.